to rejoice at the most wonderful time of the year. Merry Christmas, and joining me are a wise man, Chris McCausland. A shining star, Holly Walsh. A venerated virgin, Justin Moorhouse. It's been a while. And a bit of an ass, Alan Davis. Buzzers are all rejoicing. I will conduct you. So, Chris, if you could start us off, please.
Hallelujah.
And Holly.
Hallelujah.
And Justin.
Hallelujah.
Alan.
Hallelujah.
And because it's Christmas, I gave myself a buzzer. I want you to imagine it's Christmas Eve and you're looking for a very quick present. What beats 4 calling birds, 3 French hens, 2 turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree?
Hallelujah.
Yes! Chris?
I'm going to take one for the team and say 5 gold rings!
Oh, that's not, yeah.
I'd rather that than just have it building up inside me for
yes.
the rest of the show.
No. So I'm going to give you a clue. Those were all birds, and we're looking for the next bird on the list.
Six geese a-laying.
6 geese a-laying is absolutely right. It beats all the birds on our list in one respect, the goose.
Can fly further.
It can fly faster. Actually, to be more specific, it's a spur wing goose.
Mm.
There it is, a beautiful thing. More importantly, what impact has this question had on the world?
Has it brought down more aeroplanes than any other bird?
Wow, that's horrible. No, it's not that.
Is it responsible for the shape of wings on planes?
Oh.
I don't mean it designs them, but like...
The geese are doing the wings.
Yeah.
I've got lots of good ideas. Listen up, they can fly.
So, the book Guinness World Records, which used to be known as the Guinness Book of Records, started with an argument about the speed of game birds.
Is the book sponsored by Guinness?
So, it was originally put forward by the MD of Guinness Brewery. So, it all started in a competition to decide who knew the fastest game bird, OK?
And they were having a pint of Guinness and they thought...
No, they were out hunting game birds. So, there's a guy called Sir Hugh Eyre Campbell Beaver, and he was on a grouse... I know, it's very pleasing. It's a story.
I haven't heard that many names, that's just greed.
I know.
Also, people would call him Hugh Beaver.
Hugh Beaver.
Sir Beaver.
Huge Beaver, that's what they call him. Huge, hairy Campbell Beaver. That's what they call him behind his back. Here he comes, Huge Beaver.
The Beaver Book of Records sounds much better.
That is better.
The Book of Beaver Records.
The Guinness Book of Beavers.
The Book of Huge Beavers.
Yes. World Beaver.
What's the fastest beaver, Huge?
Beaver, right. As I like to call him, was on a grouse shoot in 1954, and he got into a row with a friend about what was the fastest European game bird. Very pleasingly, they had this discussion in a place in Ireland called North Slob.
That's me.
Anyway, so Beaver, who was the MD of Guinness Breweries, claimed it was the golden plover, and his friend said it was the grouse. And so they decided that there was a gap in the market for a book like this, and they commissioned Norris and Ross McWhirter to write this book.
Are they twins? Or were they just
dressed? They were twins.
They
were twins.
They were on Record Breakers, weren't they?
One
yes,
of them was.
Yes, with Roy Castle.
Yeah. Who do you think won? The one who thought it was the grouse and the one who thought it was the plover?
Well, it turns out it was a goose.
Exactly. The grouse is faster than the plover, but the spur-wing goose is faster than either one of those. Here's...
You know what, it all depends on where the wind's blowing, doesn't it, for a bird?
Yeah,
I think... I've seen birds sometimes where they're really not in control of what they're doing and they're just trying to style it out.
Yeah.
Just... They take off in a high wind and they're filled with regret and they can't get back to the nest and they're just trying to style it out but they're being buffeted around.
And then they come in with feet like that.
Yeah.
You know,
you see a duck landing on a pond in a high wind, that's hilarious.
Yeah,
some birds, little birds, can go at terrific speed through a bush and then just come to a standstill on a twig, defying all the laws of physics. Whereas a duck basically needs the English Channel just to come to a stop.
So the spur-wing goose is the fastest game bird in the world. What's the problem with this?
Game birds.
Yes, it's not really a game bird. So it's only found in sub-Saharan Africa. It also eats something called blister beetles, which makes the flesh entirely toxic, so you die if you ate a spur-wing goose, and it's not really a goose. Other than that, I think it's a perfect world record holder. So the book was first given away as a promotion. They printed 1,000 copies and they gave it away free with beer, but it proved to be so popular that they decided to put it on sale, and it became a Christmas bestseller that year and every year since. And in fact, Guinness World Records holds the Guinness World Record for the best-selling copyrighted book of all time.
Sounds a bit convenient, don't you?
Yeah.
I know, as they're judging,
of
right?
Of course they'd say that, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
Let's bring out the Martini Book of Real Facts.
The Cinzano Book of Lies.
What's the Aldi, Justin? Is it the Guinness Book of Records? No, it's the Carling Pamphlet of Stuff.
What I like is that the Guinness World Records 1978 edition is also listed as the book most stolen from public libraries in Britain. Other Christmassy records awarded by Guinness World Records include largest group of carol singers, was won by a Nigerian choir, 25,272 singers. This is a very good one. Fastest time, have a guess at this, fastest time to eat all the chocolates from an advent calendar in the correct order.
24 days.
12 seconds.
Seven.
It's a four. a minute and 27 seconds.
What? What's yeah. he doing?
I've done it quicker than that. Definitely.
By this guy, Kevin L.A. Beast Strahl. He also has the record for the most chicken nuggets, most powdered donuts, and drinking a litre of maple syrup.
Imagine, like, how many he's got to go through to get to that level.
I know.
He's probably got to do like 200 calendars and 50 litres of whatever it was, maple syrup, was it?
Yeah. Fastest marathon dressed as a Christmas tree, 3 hours and 43 minutes.
Oh, that's good going.
Largest gathering of people dressed as Santa Claus was broken in Kerala in India in 2014 by 18,100.
Oh, look at that!
I know. But you're going to love this. OK, the previous record for the biggest Santa gathering had been set in Newtown in Wales in 2004. More than 4,260 Santas went for an annual charity run, but it finished in a mass street brawl. Which involved 30 Santas slugging it out. So the elves and I thought, you know, how hard can these records be? We decided we're going to try and break one. So first up, Holly and Chris... fastest time to put on 5 Christmas jumpers, OK? And our judge is the editor-in-chief of Guinness World Records. Please welcome Craig Glendaig. Craig, what are the rules, darling, that we need to follow?
It is 5 jumpers you have to put on. If you have one jumper on now, that doesn't count. So, T-shirt is fine, topless is fine, but no...
are we getting up
Let's
now?
Let's do this. No, I'll do it in this.
Tell me when you're ready, darling.
Okay,
so the... Don't touch them yet.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
So they have to be on the floor.
Yeah, so in front of you are 5 jumpers that are in increasing size. Don't touch them until I say go. And make sure it's pulled down below the waist.
OK, I might punch myself out doing this.
Right, but they need to get... It's quicker than 20 seconds. Is Holly allowed to kneel to start?
That's fine.
Do you
as
want
long
to...
as you can't... I can't actually see it. As long as you're touching the
kneeling
jumpers.
Down.
I can confirm...
Do you want to kneel, Chris?
She's not touching the jumpers.
It brings back bad memories of church.
OK.
For several reasons.
OK.
Actually, no, Holly, I do need you to stand.
Holly, get up, you cheat.
Over to you, Craig, to get us going.
3, 2, 1, go.
Look for any more.
How was that, Craig?
It was interesting. I think Holly You clocked a time of 31 seconds, but you didn't seem to be standing.
I'm short.
But are you standing now, or...?
Yes.
Yeah, no, then you were shorter during the attempt, so... I think I might have to disqualify
you.
And also, where is the waistline?
This is such a personal question to ask.
You think it's bad there's people watching this at home now going, that lad sat next to Sandy, he's already wearing 15 jumpers.
And Chris?
How did I do then, Craig?
Well, you did 35 seconds. I was happy that it was a valid attempt.
Yeah.
But yes, the minimum, unfortunately, for this record, which is based on existing speed jumper wearing, is 20 seconds.
Oh.
So I'm afraid it's not.
Craig, can I ask a serious question though? What is the record for a blind man putting on 5 jumpers?
Right now, it's
35
seconds.
Hey! Does that mean we can expect to see you in the next edition of the book?
I wanted to check that previous applicants weren't already blind. So if that's the case, then maybe.
You know, just because we can't read it.
Chris, he's saying maybe and shaking his head no. Just telling you now. Well done for trying. Yes. That's fantastic.
This is the least sexy Christmas striptease you'll ever see.
No, it's working for me.
It's like a game of Holly Pass the Parcel.
Make sure you stop. Well done. Good. Fantastic. Well, I'm only sorry I didn't try. It did look like such fun. What horrible incident involving Dijon befell Father Christmas in 1951?
Did somebody put mustard on a mince pie?
Oh, that would be bad, wouldn't it?
I love mustard.
You like mustard?
Oh, I could eat I eat mouthfuls of it raw.
Really? Which, yeah. French mustard or English mustard?
French.
Dijon?
Yes, and whole grain.
I can only eat that stuff. I can't eat the English stuff that goes up the back of your nose.
Yeah.
Burns my eyeballs.
Yeah.
Not that it matters, but... I like the stuff with the seeds in it, but did he fall into a vat of mustard or something?
No, it has nothing to do with mustard. We're talking about the French city of Dijon. It's to do with Christmas. It's the early 1950s, and the Catholic Church was very cross. They thought that Christmas had become too commercialised and it should be more about le petit Jésus than presents. And so...
Something happened to Santa.
Yes, something did happen to Santa.
In the town.
Yes.
Did he get hung?
Yes.
They hung Santa?
They hung Santa.
They hung him?
Yes. Who hung Santa?
OK, the Catholics. That's
it. Catholic?
Yes.
The Dijon Cathedral in 1951, on December the 23rd. 250 school children hanged an 8-foot-tall Santa effigy.
That's so bleak. The kids turned on Santa.
Oh, it's even worse. So there's a young man. He asked the crowd, does Santa deserve death? And the assembled children chanted back, yes, 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 before setting fire to the effigy and pelting it with orange peel.
Oh, my God. It was the church.
The church did it, yes. So the Archbishop of Rennes, he said it demonstrated that the church was pushing back against the paganism which Santa seemed to bring with
him. How's that worked out for them, indeed?
Well, the very next day there was a pro-Santa rally outside the town hall.
Oh, my God.
Santa!
Yeah. So Santa has been in trouble all over the world. He's faced challenges. 1920s in the Soviet Union, Christmas itself was banned for years. There was a sort of wave of anti-Christmas sentiment all the way through Soviet Russia. One school put on a play where fictional characters were expelled as non-Soviet elements. Cinderella was tried for betraying the working class and Father Frost was accused of spying on people down their chimneys. And it wasn't until 1937 that Father Frost or Dead Morris was allowed to return, but he has to wear a blue coat so that we don't think he's the Western...
Because he works at Pontins.
Yeah, it's rather like the Puritans under Oliver Cromwell and in parts of the United States when the forefathers arrived, they followed Oliver Cromwell's idea that you didn't have Christmas at all. It was seen as popish excess. So carol singing was seen as a political statement. People used to do secret carol singing.
Wow. Ding dong merrily on. They love Silent Night.
In the 1930s, Mexico's Ministry of Education decided that children shouldn't learn about Santa Claus anymore, but gifts should be given by an old Mesoamerican god, Quetzalcoatl, who takes the form of a feathered snake. I mean, all due respect to Mesoamerican culture and everything, I'm not sure this is the one for the kids, because this guy burnt himself to death out of shame after getting drunk and having sex with his sister.
I mean, it's Christmas. We've all had a drink.
I know. Right, it's time for another socially distanced record attempt, specially created for us by Guinness World Records, and we are going to do the most Christmas crackers pulled by an individual in 30 seconds. OK, the number to beat is 20. Craig is here to judge again. Alan and Justin, you're going to be taking this one on. So there's an important condition, isn't there, Craig, that we have to be able to hear the bang of each cracker, is that right?
Yeah, each cracker has to crack, so we'll count them backstage to make sure each of the papers
has actually gone.
Exploded. Yeah.
OK, so you may put your crackers out on your on a table in front of you. Oh, that's my boy. So I don't know what your technique's going to be. Are you going to have
losing them all over the...
Is it one person doing
one
this?
Person pulling the crackers.
Do we have to do one at once?
Is that right, Craig?
Yeah, one cracker at a time.
One cracker at a time, yeah.
Do you have to read all the jokes and put all the hats on?
Oh, wait a minute, because all the gifts might fly out, I'm just going to put
on... Good to wear goggles, good idea.
Because, honestly, a pack of playing cards... OK, I've got my safety glasses.
Come on, Al.
Right, hand over to Craig.
OK, so start with your hands behind your back, please.
Oh.
Do you want to change how you've got them, darling?
I'm not going to do 20 in 30 seconds, Sandy.
Yes, you are. I've got every face in
it. No, I think this is a perfect layout.
OK.
Just use both hands.
Have you got everything ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
OK.
Can I just say, Sandy, I'm psyched for this.
OK, good.
Yeah.
So this one, you have to stop when the music does.
OK.
Craig?
OK, you have 30 seconds in 3, 2, 1, go.
One.
Two.
Go! 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 What a nice technique.
15,
14, 15, 15. You've got this,
Stop!
I feel alive! I feel giddy!
But look at
the
that!
The smell of gunpowder!
Look at that! That could have had my eye out. There are nail clippers.
Environmentally, this is a disaster as well.
Yeah.
It smells incredible.
What did Father Christmas do when he went speed dating?
He pulled a cracker.
He pulled a cracker!
How do you know when Santa's in the room?
Oh, I don't know.
Because the residents of Dijon have hung and burnt him.
Right, we'll bring the news to you as soon as we have it as to whether or not the record has been broken, but it was looking pretty good, I think. Do you ever get Christmas cards from people but have no idea who they are? Has that ever happened?
The worst Christmas card I ever got wasn't a Christmas card, it was a note came through the post, said, we've got some post for you, but the person's not paid enough for it. So I had to go to the post office and pay £1.50 for a Christmas card from someone who came to my house the next day for Christmas lunch.
That's a rotten thing. Have a look at some Christmas cards that you've got under the desk. Now, Chris, let me tell you about your card.
Can I open it?
Yes, so one of the elves spent ages writing it in Braille for you.
Oh, my God, there's Braille in it. I don't read Braille.
amazingly, I've
been helping yourself here,
right? I mean, if we're honest, it's just dots, isn't it? No, I'm not a very good blind person, but that's very thoughtful. I mean,
yeah, they did
God
try.
Knows what it says.
No. What does yours say?
Mine says, Merry Christmas from Phil and Joyce.
OK, and you two?
Mine says, warmest wishes this festive season, Dr and Mrs Kunz. Christmas Kunz but once a year.
Yeah. OK, so yours, Chris and Alan, yours say Phil and Joyce, and yours say Dr and Mrs Kunz. So this has actually been tried. There were two sociologists from Brigham Young University called Philip Kunz, which is where the name comes from, and Michael Woolcott, and they sent out 578 Christmas cards to random addresses in the United States to see how many people would write back. It was really impressive. One person in five sent Christmas greetings in return, as if they knew who the person was, and what they discovered was you got better results if you sent out a higher status card. So if you signed it, Dr and Mrs Kunz, you got a 26% return. Phil and Joyce, just 15%. But some people sent back letters that were 3 or 4 pages long. And a few people kept sending cards for 15 years.
Mm.
This particular study was in 1975. They tried it again in 2015 and only got replies from 2% of recipients, so it has changed. Now, what was the Immaculate Conception?
Yes. The Immaculate Conception is when the Virgin Mary...
Yes.
..became pregnant with the Holy Spirit.
No. Lots of people think it's to do with the virgin birth. It has nothing to do with the virgin birth of Jesus. So whose birth is it to do with?
Is it Mary's birth?
It is to do with Mary's birth. So Catholics believe that she was conceived and born without original sin, which, apart from Adam and Eve, would make her unique, I think, in history. So it doesn't mean she was born by virgin birth. It means that she could go on to be Christ's mother because she didn't have any original sin. So immaculate just means not stained. Macula in Latin is for stain or blemish. So according to the church, she never committed a single sin in her entire life. This is a marvellous painting by Leonardo, and that's her mother in the background there, St. Anne. But it was officially made part of the Catholic doctrine by Pope Pius IX in 1854. In 2006, there was a British insurance firm that had to withdraw cover from three virgin sisters in Inverness. They had taken out insurance against getting pregnant in the event of a second coming of Christ. If one of them had given birth as a virgin, they stood to gain £1 million to help with the childcare.
Insurance companies don't pay out with acts of God, though.
Well... I know, but the burden of proof that they had been impregnated by the Holy Ghost was most specifically resting with them in the policy. They eventually withdrew it due to what can only be described as adverse headlines. Of course, that got further headlines, my favourite of which is Sisters Lose Second Coming Cover.
There's a withdrawal joke in there as well.
Yeah, there is. The Immaculate Conception is actually a bit of an inaccurate misconception. We have a news flash, everybody. I have the results of the Christmas cracker pulling.
Ooh. I'm actually quite excited.
OK. I am.
I can tell you that Justin got 30 with four that didn't crack. Alan got 35 with seven that didn't crack, which makes Alan the new world record! Yay!
Wow, my kids are going to love it. Am I going to be in the thing?
Golly, it's even better. You're going to get a certificate. You're going to get a certificate as a world record holder.
I have never been as disappointed.
I now know the first line of your obituary, Alan. That's quite exciting.
And if the BBC had paid for a better quality of cracker, you'd have had 42.
That's a puller.
Yeah. Anyway, congratulations. I'm proud to know you. Now it's time to get onto our tea tray and slide down the icy slopes of general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. What kind of room was Jesus born in?
Stable.
Just not got winner written all over you tonight, have you, Justin?
No.
So sorry, darling. No, not a stable. What else?
Premier Inn.
A travel lodge.
So there is no mention in the Bible whatsoever of Jesus being born in a stable, and also the idea that there was no room at the inn seems entirely wrong. So the Greek word, which traditionally is translated as inn, is katalumo. It actually means something more like guest room. So we know perfectly well the Bible states that Joseph had relatives in Bethlehem. The likeliest explanation is that kataluma refers to there being no space in the guest room at his relative's house. And he was born in a manger, we do know that. So it's a feeding trough, well, that is mentioned in the Bible. But that probably just means he was born in the ground floor living area. You often brought the animals in to keep it nice and warm and so on. So the chances are that he was actually just born in a crowded family house. If you actually get a genuine inn mentioned in the Bible, it's a different word. It's pandokion, which means place where strangers are welcome.
I really look forward to your Christmas sermon.
Yes. In fact, the only Gospels that mention the Nativity are Matthew and Luke, and they have completely different versions. Matthew mentions the wise men visiting. Luke mentions the shepherds.
John talks about watching The Great Escape at 4 o'clock.
Mark and John, the other Gospels, don't mention the Nativity at all. Now, who wrote Oliver Twist and Nicholas Nickleby?
Oliver Twist. That's not right. No. So these are kind of, what, spoofy Charles Dickens?
Yes, Justin.
Is it Dick Charles?
It might as well have been, is the truth of it. He was so popular. There were loads of knockoff versions of his most famous works. So there was Barnaby Budge, David Copper, Full, Martin Guzzlewit, The Penny Pickwick. And these all sold phenomenally well.
But were they actually the story?
Well, the story was written by a man called Thomas Peckett Prest. I have to say, Thomas's versions were a little bit sexier. So Nancy in Oliver Twist, renamed as Paul Smiggins, has a, let's call it a more sexually explicit backstory. So they're a little bit racier. But there was no law stopping anybody selling these kind of knockoffs until the Copyright Act of 1842.
Sounds like the modern day equivalent would be if you only watched the porn version of films instead of the original.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
David Ryan's Private.
There you go.
Tale of Two Cities.
David Ryan.
Goodwill Humping.
Right, time now for our final record attempt. The fastest time to dress up as Santa Claus.
Whoa.
Okay. So you can see I've already got part of it on. I was going to do this myself, but one of the conditions is that you have to start out in your underwear. So I've asked my son Theo to do it for me. He looks so much better in his unmentionables than I do.
Oh, he's not wearing your underwear?
No, he's not wearing my underwear. The time to beat is 30.94 seconds. I'm going to hand over to Craig for the last time. Any rules about this, Craig?
It's approved. Guinness World Records approved. Santa outfit. You know you have to put it all on exactly as it's presented. And when you're done, hands up and say stop or ho, 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 or whatever you... Stop is quicker. You have 30.94 seconds to beat. So I'll give you a 3, 2, 1.
OK.
Come on.
And then at the end...
We're burning.
Burning.
Yeah.
Ready?
Can I just ask Alan to give me some radio commentary on this?
Certainly. Certainly.
Over to Alan in the commentary box.
He's standing up. Near some Santa Claus.
Are we ready?
Yes. Yeah.
3, 2, 1, go.
Go!
So you had 30.94 to beat, and you achieved 28.
Yeah! Is that it? Has he done it?
He's done it.
Yeah!
Proud,
Sam. Oh, both my boys, Alan and Theo. This has been a very important Christmas for me. This is the point where I traditionally do the scores, but it's Christmas, so everyone is a winner! From Justin, Holly, Chris, Alan and me, and Merry Christmas to you all, you filthy animals. Good night.